My feeling is when I read those texts, I don't want to be a social scientist anymore.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So my joke was that those textbooks were written by Ph.D.
I see. Local time, everyone. I'm Audrey Tang, and welcome to this new episode of Innovative Minds, 唐凤尬创新. Today, we continue our focus on innovation in the world of ideas with a renowned economics researcher, Cyrus Chu. So Cyrus, you're the youngest person ever to be elected as the member of our National Academy, 中央研究院, our most preeminent academic institution. And you're also the international member of the National Academy of Science in the United States. So would you like to start by sharing your academic background? When did you make up your mind to do your research in economics and what excites you about the field?
Actually, this is a very standard process, just carrot and stick.
Okay.
So when I started to do research in economics, I perform relatively well, and that's carrot. So I got stimulated and started to move on, next step. There were no too much punishment in the process.
I see, the incentives.
Just very traditional process. Then gradually move on to this economics. I believe it's also the same thing for most people. They do not, quote, find their interest.
I see.
They just gradually move on to that interest.
Okay, but your research topic is anything but standard, right? Rather than following the traditional age group research, which was standard in your field at the time, you have proposed an entirely new framework by classifying populations according to various other variables and making it possible to analyze multi-generational issues. So tell us more about how this, I think, it's okay to call it innovation, right? How does innovation occur to you?
Innovation, I would say it's something related to wild mind. Research, I believe it's in the Webster Dictionary, something like research is study or investigation of facts not readily available. Traditionally, in ancient time, when we look at people, because most of their traits, their characteristics do not change over time, or nothing particularly persistent in their time. So when we think about Moses, he would describe people just like animals.
I see.
When we populate too much, they started to shrink.
Okay.
That's the traditional study of population. But when we look back, say, 250 years ago, when Industrial Revolution started, there is something called class. So Karl Marx classified people into capitalist and labor. And Thomas Piketty, probably 20 years ago, started to classify people into the wealthy group and the poor group. So that is the saying changes when there are some traits persistently stick with people. So if we look at that way, we don't have to look at people mechanically and to classify them into ages. We can classify them into classes, social classes, income groups, and various other things. So most of my early time research started from there.
Okay. You received your PhD from the University of Michigan around 85, I believe. So enlighten us about how this period shaped your worldview and your academic insight.
I don't think my worldview was mature by 1985 or anything close to that. I believe probably 7 or 8 years ago, I gave a lecture to high school students. That was the humanities and social science group, high school students. They are 16 years old. The topic of my speech was 40 years ago, I know nothing. 中文就是40年前我懂个屁。
Okay. Wow. Okay.
So if 40 years ago I don't know too much, I don't think I can describe myself as a solid worldview by that age. If we reflect, Confucius says, 十五志于学, 三十而立, 四十而不惑. So at least you have to have 40 to have a comprehensive.
Okay, I'm 40 this year, so taking this as a compliment.
50, 五十, I don't know. I don't think I can have a solid worldview by the age of 30 when I received my PhD. I think I would say that roughly only 10 years ago, I can have a very solid, comprehensive view of the world.
But what,
so
was
that's
there,
very late.
Was there a kind of pivoting moment that made you say, aha, I'm a mature person now?
No, I think it's an accumulating process. It's a very slow process.
I
perhaps
see.
In the near 1 or 2 years in the future, I may still change. So people adapt, modify. So today, say, Russia invaded Ukraine. Without that, your view about Europe may be very different from
that's correct.
Is today. So nobody has a solid, unchanged, persistent view of the world in their life.
Right, so there's the only thing that doesn't change is change itself, right?
Yeah.
It'll just keep changing. So because this show is also partly about open government and open government data, most people nowadays think Taiwan is doing pretty well in open government data, but it's not always the case. And not many people know that from your time as a minister in our cabinet, you were actually one of the first proponents of open government data. And you also mentioned Piketty, and as I understand that in 2015-ish, right, you work with him on the taxation and wealth distribution, and you offered the research material about the Taiwan inequality and so on. How was the open government data situation back then? Was it easy to get those data? And if you have any anecdotes on how you contributed to our open data policy, I would be very happy to hear from you.
The work I work with Tom Piketty was on taxation data. Our Ministry of Finance has a very good and comprehensive personal income and wealth data. They had those data available starting from 2013 until now. It's a very long period. And they have very comprehensive income data. If you know, we have a comprehensive income tax, and that's income including 10 kinds, salary income, stock interest income, things like that. Other than those income data, we also have four wealth data, housing, land, stock, and cars. We have all those data identified by the ID numbers. So if we trace individuals for, say, 10 years using those data. I'm sorry, I have to adjust. The data start from 2003, not 13. So it's a very long period of time. So you have a very rich data. Those data are not available in even very well, very rich country, United States. They don't have wealth data. They have income data. Japan. they don't have combined data because they don't have ID numbers. Mm-hmm. The only place in the world that have similar quality data is Nordic countries, Scandinavian countries. Mm-hmm. So we are in a very good position using parallelly good quality data to do research to be aligned with the world.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. So since 2003, the Ministry of Finance has been collecting this data because it was entirely digitized, our taxation process. And were you, as a researcher, finding this data good for research purposes? Did you encounter any issues in applying to use such data, like by asking for a certain way to do statistics over these data and so on? Was the ministry cooperative in your research?
Yes, the Ministry of Finance is very cooperative. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. They have a rule that anyone use that data mm-hmm. has to go to their computer room to follow their protocols
for cybersecurity reasons.
So for security reasons. Mm-hmm. But sometimes they don't have this loan. For instance, housing and land. Mm-hmm. We know. Mr. A has a house, mm-hmm. The market value or assessed value mm-hmm. is something, mm-hmm. but we don't know its loan.
I see.
Their loan data is regulated by mm-hmm. Security Exchange Commission.
Yeah, I don't know what the finance name. Supervisory.
Yeah, Financial Supervisory mm-hmm. Commission. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Across ministries, mm-hmm. the data can never merge.
I see.
I was trying to make it happen mm-hmm. somehow. If the data can merge mm-hmm. in mm-hmm. still regulated by the Ministry of Finance, mm-hmm. anyone want to use that still has mm-hmm. to access to that
like
computer room.
Secure enclave that said it's saved by FSC and also MOF.
Yes, but that request was denied.
I see.
Because they allow you to use that data only once.
I see.
And then have to destroy the data. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I don't think that's scientific because mm-hmm. Any mm-hmm. research has to be double checked.
Replicable.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So if you only use it only once, there's no way to replicate the mm-hmm. the analysis. Mm-hmm. So that's the obstacle mm-hmm. I face. So okay. glad you asked today.
Yes. On that, I think during the pandemic, a couple of years, we've really figured out how to use API, the application programming interfaces, to make sure that we make the data storage and data use two very different concepts. Yeah. And we can prove through what we call the zero knowledge proofs or homomorphic encryption, very jargon words, mm-hmm. That the people doing the compute has no access to the raw data, but they can still make replicable results. So really happy that we're working on something that is an improvement since 2015. So Cyrus, in the course of your career, you have also once moved from the world of research into the world of public affairs. In 2011, you started working in the cabinet in the position I'm in right now, the Minister with a portfolio, and then in 2012 as the leader of the National Science Council. Now in 2016, you started a new journey as Taiwan's diplomat, a ambassador, and permanent representative to the World Trade Organization. Now, we know that we joined as the 144th WTO member on January 2002, a few weeks after Beijing. And Taiwan has long faced challenges about how we're named and treated in international multilateral organizations. So can you tell us a little bit more about your experience in Geneva representing the separate customs territory of Taiwan, Penghu, and Kinmen and Matsu Islands?
Oh, I have a friend who is a professor of economics in the University of Chicago. Uh-huh. He said, I quote, Taiwan's diplomat may be the most frustrating job in the world. We all know our diplomatic position. Uh-huh. We face China's suppression all the time. Uh-huh. One of the things is that they never allow, through the Secretariat of WTO, they give us pressure, never allowed us to use Taiwan mm-hmm. In any place, in our business card, mm-hmm. in our letterhead, mm-hmm. anything. Mm-hmm. So I can tell a little story. We had an orchid exhibition. Mm-hmm. We sent out invitation letters
okay.
on the letterhead. This is a personal letter. This is not official. I write ambassador.
Sure.
And China protest. And then we received a formal notice from the Switzerland government.
Wow.
Ministry of Foreign Affairs. They asked, they invite our deputy to their office to say that you have to drop that.
Oh, wow.
Otherwise, you will face some consequence, something like that. So from then on, in our WTO documents, we are officially not allowed to use this and that.
Oh, wow.
I was frustrated.
Of course.
And upset.
Of course.
So I figured out a way.
Oh.
I went to Burgundy.
Okay.
Used my gift budget to auction a barrel of wine.
Okay.
The winner of the auction has the privilege is to design the label. So on that label, I chose the word China hate most.
Okay.
Mission of Taiwan to WTO. That's not our official name.
No.
But that's the name they don't like to see most.
Of course.
And I use that. A barrel can fill in 288 bottles.
Yep.
I use that bottle of wine to send as gift to other diplomats.
Right.
So they can see that this is from the mission of Taiwan to the WTO.
But it's describing a wine.
Describing a wine. And that is not designed by my mission, but designed by the winemaker.
Okay, that's very innovative.
That's one way. Another story.
Okay.
It's related to the current ambassador, Luo Changfa.
Yes.
He was trying to run for the appellate body member. Or in common term, as the higher court, the judicial system of WTO. In the document, he says his previous job was a professor of law, National Taiwan University. His current job is the constitutional court judge, 司法院大法官. China protested. Say, if you use this name, in by the way, law. Judge Low failed this competition, but even failed candidates, they list, say they listed nine people.
Yeah.
They say three of them was passed.
Yep.
But even failed people, they attached their veto.
Yeah, they're like so, a shortlist.
Yeah, they protested and asked to drop his name. Asked me to change his veto.
Wow.
I said, how can I change other people's veto?
Yeah, how does that
work?
I can
only change my veto.
Yes.
He said he cannot be graduated from National Taiwan University.
I see.
How could you have anything national?
Okay.
He cannot be a constitutional court judge because you don't have constitution.
Okay, we don't? Okay.
So what do you do?
Uh-huh.
That's the kind of experience we face almost every week. So the way I handle it, that was the first week I went to WTO. So the Ministry of Foreign Affairs gave me a telegram say, you cannot change a word. If I disobey, I'll be back in 1 week.
I see.
Okay.
Shortest life ambassador
yes.
ever.
Yes. But if I disobey the secretary, I cannot be an ambassador anymore because I offended most other members because they stopped the meeting because of this controversy.
Oh, wow.
They all wait for us.
Okay.
They all wait for my concession. So what do you do?
Yeah, what do you do?
What I did is to ask the secretary, general secretary to a room. One by one. I never said that's in the public before.
Okay. Wow.
One by one.
Exclusive.
Exclusive. Exclusive. I said Harvard University Chemistry Department had an opening last year.
Okay.
26 people apply from A to Z. Finally, they recruited Mr. A.
Okay.
But when the department chair filed the case to the dean, he doesn't have to include any name and any data from B to Z. Because all those peoples are excellent people. You don't want to include the people, a person on the record, he said he failed.
I see.
So if you exclude failed candidate's name, you say you solve your problem and that's how I solve mine. UWTO made a mistake in the past. You include failed candidate's name.
Okay.
And the reason you do this is because you want to correct your previous mistakes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's how I saw it.
And then they changed their ways.
They changed it.
Oh, wow. That's super innovative.
But that's a painful experience.
I know.
That's very painful.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't sleep for 2 days.
So I've been in those places too.
That's why my friends said I agree. This is a very frustrating job.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember appearing in APEC-related lectures and so on.
Yes.
And then I chose my name, card, my title as digitalminister.tw, all lowercase. I'm like, .tw, it's a domain name and so on. But the very reason that we have to do that, of course, is in our multilateral organizations. There's so far not a lot of precedents that we can cite.
Yeah.
Like say, oh, we're just Taiwan in, say, the Summit for Democracy and so on. So creating new precedents may be needed for the next decade or two.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we'll be sharing a lot more frustration.
Yeah. It's fine on the wine label.
I know. It's fine as a domain name.
Okay.
Right. All right. So, but during your time in WTO, as I understand it, there's a lot of tension between, especially the U.S. And the Beijing regime about trade and fairness that they faced, for example, 5G network situation and so on. I mean, in Taiwan, we debated around whether we allow the so-called private sector from the Beijing regime into our 4G infrastructure around 2014. That was a hot topic during the Sunflower Movement. Mm-hmm. But most of us talk about it as a cybersecurity issue, as a human rights issue, and so on. But we've noted that you basically had this idea that we can phrase this entire blocking of the internet not just as a human rights or security issue, but as a trade-related issue. So can you share with us a little bit about this innovation?
We all know the importance of human rights. Mm-hmm. I think human rights or free flow of information mm-hmm. is in a higher position than mm-hmm. business.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes when you criticize, whenever any country criticizes China about its human rights, mm-hmm. he says that's our domestic affair. Mm-hmm. Has nothing to do with you.
Mm-hmm.
And then most other countries shut up
mm-hmm.
because indeed that's their mm-hmm. domestic business.
Mm-hmm.
However, sometimes those domestic business are related to international business. So whenever you block mm-hmm. the internet,
mm-hmm.
so they have a firewall.
Yes.
So that mm-hmm. 1.4 billion people cannot access to Momo of Taiwan.
Yeah, without a very slow VPN.
Yes.
But yes.
Yeah. cannot access to mm-hmm. Amazon. They can only access to their mm-hmm. local Amazon webpage.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Or cannot access to C discount mm-hmm. of which is a French e-commerce website platform.
Mm-hmm.
When they have those firewalls, the internet blocks, it creates asymmetric market access
mm-hmm.
because 350 million U.S. people can access to mm-hmm. Alibaba.
And they do.
Yeah. Yeah. And 1.4 billion people uh-huh. cannot access to mm-hmm. Amazon.
Mm-hmm.
Then there must be unfair trade because only the Americans can buy Chinese commodities, mm-hmm. but Chinese cannot buy American commodities. So are the cases for China versus France, China versus England, China versus Germany.
Mm-hmm.
So without free flow of information or with internet blocks, despite it's a human rights issue, it creates an unfair business issue.
I see.
So I just to promote these ideas, mm-hmm. communicate with mm-hmm. United States,
mm-hmm.
French,
mm-hmm.
Germany,
mm-hmm.
Britain.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever I say this to any other country,
mm-hmm.
they get upset.
Oh.
For instance, if you connect from Paris to China,
mm-hmm.
per click waiting time mm-hmm. is about 1 second.
That's right.
But if you connect from Beijing
mm-hmm.
to see this kind of mm-hmm. France, the per-click waiting time is something like 59 seconds.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So if you need 10 clicks to complete a transaction, you get crazy.
Yep.
Nobody would in China would connect to C-discount to spend 10, 6 minutes.
It's a terrible experience. Right.
So whenever I show this evidence and I send my friends worldwide to tabulate all the waiting times both ways and show this evidence to whatever country. And then they know that internet block hurt their benefit, their business benefit. And this is a very useful cutting point to free flow of information. Again, I understand free flow of information or human right is utmost important, but sometimes you cannot attack that issue directly. We have to attack the implications, the unfair trade implications. That's what I do in WTO.
That's extremely innovative. So you have an upcoming book about that, as I understand?
Yes, I co-authored with Luo Changfa and two other young scholars, legal scholars, to compile those unfair competition issues into a book entitled Ultimate Economic Conflicts Between China and the Democratic Countries.
I see.
You see, internet causes unfair trade of e-commerce. That's the fundamental thing is authoritarian regime versus democracy. Because United States cannot retaliate. If they want to retaliate, they have to block the U.S. citizens' access to China. That's impossible.
They have a constitution, by the way, with amendments.
Yes. that's impossible. That's the fundamental difference between democracy and authoritarian states.
Yep.
So e-commerce is one example. We list several examples, compile them into a systematic way to analyze the differences between authoritarian regimes and democracy.
That's excellent. So we also noted that this year there's this idea of Indo-Pacific economic framework, which includes only more democratic economies in its construction. And a lot of the main ideas around it is around this free flow of information, but also about encouraging more fair competition, startups, and so on. And as I understand, the last time we met, you have this novel approach of analyzing the state subsidies that only authoritarian governments can do. So I wonder whether you would like to share with our audience that view, and also what's the bearing of these ideas about fair competition around the Indo-Pacific economic framework of this year.
Okay. The year I went to WTO was 2016.
16.
I believe the trade war between United States and China started something like 2017.
Yep.
And I am an economist. I've been a minister of science and technology or National Science Council.
Yep, the NSC.
Yes. So this strange combination of economics and technology facilitated some of the analysis I did. And in 2017, 18, Donald Trump announced, in 2015, China announced Made in China 2025.
Yep.
They said there's 10 industries, they're going to be leaders, one of the leaders. And President Trump announced that we're going to tax you after 7 years.
Yes.
They didn't get much echo from WTO because taxing something not existing today is weird. You tax things.
No, we don't even know how they look like.
We don't even know there's a product. But we somehow understand there's some unfairness there. For instance, those 10 industries of Made in China 2025 are all high-tech industries. So government subsidies can facilitate, say, Huawei to be temporary leader today. But those high-tech industries has the property of increasing returns. So whenever you're leading today, it's more likely you'll be leader tomorrow.
Yep.
Everybody knows that 5G or even future 6G, Huawei is the leader of China. But in the United States, if you want to identify one company for 5G.
Well, there's a few labs in universities.
It's difficult.
We
can think of Qualcomm.
Yeah.
It's a leading chip design company. But Qualcomm does not have a GDTI.
That's right. It doesn't have the base station stack, right? It's just part of the ecosystem.
Yeah. If you put Qualcomm into the business map of Huawei, it's just a minor point.
It's like one division, right?
Yeah, one division, very small division. So China can support an authoritarian country, can support a business in whatever way they want. They can consolidate without any antitrust thing, like in the United States. In the United States, if you want to consolidate, if you want to merge Qualcomm and Apple. It's impossible.
Yeah, it's unheard of.
It's unlikely to happen because of a check and balance. Yep. So also the difference between authoritarian country and democratic ones is one of the most important things is check and balances. And that applies to government subsidy will make China extremely advantaged to create a big consolidated firm to compete with isolated small branches, firms of democratic countries. So Made in China 2025, if you cut in from this angle, you see the issue very clearly.
So many economies also have grants to universities or to startups as they were just incubating their ideas, research grants, and they may be actually quite high when you measure the government output. So how is that different from subsidy into the Huawei empire back in 2015?
Yeah, as I said, in democratic countries, our subsidies are checked and balanced in general. There are three major things. One, for pure science, we can subsidize anything.
It's probably good.
Yeah. There's no direct beneficiary of that grant. For technologies with unspecified benefits, yes, we can do that for incubation.
It's general purpose.
Yes. And the third thing is for small and medium-sized firms, we can subsidize them to adapt some already existing technologies. That's the basic check and balance framework in democratic countries. But in China, no. They can appoint a city to do the field experiment of 5G. How could the United States appoint a state or even a county to do the experiment of Qualcomm's new chip?
Unlikely.
It's unlikely. So that's the fundamental imbalance, asymmetry of government subsidies, and that gives China competitive advantage.
So if they have this authoritarian, unfair advantage, let's call it that, what's the counter move from democracies? What kind of responses should democracies operate as economies or as alliances in like new frameworks like the Indo-Pacific one to counter this advantage by the authoritarian regimes?
As a scholar, what I do is to point out this systematic asymmetry or unfairness. How to perceive that is related to international politics. I would say that the Pacific Indo framework is a 2.0 version of CPTPP. Originally it was TPP.
What's the TPP?
Yeah. But the United States withdrew, so it's inconvenient for them to rejoin or things like that. So that may be a 2.0
reincarnate
version. Yes. But I had a description that I would say that the United States built three walls in the past 100 years. The first wall was NATO.
Okay.
1947 or something.
And now very famous because of Ukraine.
Yes. And that war was a military, political war. Mm-hmm. The second war was Obama tries to build a CPTPP. Mm-hmm. That's a custom tariff war. Mm-hmm. Within the war, we have low tariff or zero tariff. Mm-hmm. Outside the war, we have a very high barrier.
Yeah.
The third war was accidentally built by Mr. Trump. Mm-hmm. President Trump tried to build a Mexican wall,
yes,
but failed.
I'm aware of that.
But he kind of created a science and technology war by banning ZTE, by entity list of Huawei, by perhaps in the future banning TikTok. Mm-hmm. Huawei and ZTE are hardwares. Mm-hmm. TikTok is software. Mm-hmm. And if TikTok is related to data, because big data is a kind of massive destructive weapon.
It is. It could be weaponized.
Yes. Big data plus AI is very dangerous. So that future science and technology war, I don't know how wide, how thick, how high the war is, but it possibly includes hardware, software, and kind of data. That's the kind of naturally formed alliance. That alliance is not politically motivated, but I can see that there is some possibility it's becoming true, because the regime differences between authoritarian states and the democratic country are becoming clear and clear. So whenever those things are more evident. That was why the United States tried to ban TikTok, because some disadvantage has appeared. So that's a naturally formed alliance, other than the internationally politics formed alliance.
So it's not just chips anymore. It could be data, it could be code, it could be things on the software side.
Yeah, just like they ban, they tried to ban TikTok. That's a pure software thing.
Okay. Thank you. So, Cyrus, based on your rich experience, it is reported that you often say to young scholars, don't restrict yourself, be wild, right? That's the quote. So, and you yourself is a slashy, as we say here, a multiple hyphenate, right? Not just a diplomat or researcher, but also a writer and a very avid book reader, and also someone who popularizes social science to high school students and so on. So, in your own words, share with us, how do you think about this idea of being wild in your mind, something that probably liberal democracies are better at?
Relatively, I would say you may agree that Taiwanese students are suppressed pretty much in their elementary, junior high education. My experience was that at the age of 13, we were asked to make sentences, 造句. The teacher gave me was 大吃一惊, shocked, surprised.
Caught by surprise.
I made the sentence, when the police find out the case was committed by blah, 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 they were shocked.
Okay.
And that blah, 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 I fill in the name of the teacher.
Okay, wow. That's very shocking.
I was just... try to have fun.
Yeah, sure.
13 years old, I don't have any experience that may not be polite, but I was severely punished.
Okay.
And that killed my wildness somehow. Otherwise, I'll be wilder today.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Anyway, that's the process. We killed our wildness. The reason I like to teach high school students is to keep their wildness, is to provide them a different way of looking at social sciences, a way that is not described in a textbook. I try to teach them those things.
Can you give an example of what's not in textbooks that they would be interested in?
shocked.
Shocked. Okay, yes.
That's one.
Elements of surprise.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Okay. But you've, of course, kind of, you're very much known as someone who promotes general education. So we talk a little bit about high schools and your high school story, but also colleges. And you spent a lot of time for years in colleges popularizing the humanities, social sciences, economics also. So why is that? Why do you work on this field of education?
The reason I would like to do the teaching to high school students mm-hmm. is that, honestly, I think our high school textbook of social sciences, 公民, uh-huh. is poorly written.
公民 as in the civics class.
公民 includes, it's almost mm-hmm. a very, very fundamental introduction of social science.
I see.
They have uh-huh. one semester of law, uh-huh.
yes.
One semester of economics.
Oh yeah. Civics and public life.
Yes. Uh-huh. My feeling is, when I read those texts, I don't want to be a social scientist anymore.
Oh wow. Okay.
So my joke was that those textbooks were written by Ph.D.
I see. Okay.
They tried to kill our
enemies
youngsters.
Of your field.
Yes. They tried to kill the. Uh-huh. The fire of yeah. our youngsters. Uh-huh. That's why I try to teach them in a different, very different way.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And one of your teachings is quite different, yet a little bit similar to another often quoted saying by Steve Jobs, yeah. who once elaborated on his idea about life, saying, and I quote, live each day as if it's the last day, end of quote. However, it seems that you think in a kind of opposing manner, because you said, live each day as if it's the first day of your life. Now, they're not logically incompatible, right? It could be just a single day. But anyway, why do you want to approach each day as the first day in your life? What does that mean?
Okay, let me say first, why do I not like uh-huh. Each day as the last day?
Yeah.
On the last day mm-hmm. of our lives, mm-hmm. we've seen almost too many things.
Yeah.
Most of the routes we can choose are already there. Mm-hmm. Most of the decisions we can possibly make mm-hmm. are already framed.
Ah, as in pre-committed, yes.
Also, uh-huh. Most of the environment mm-hmm. we consider are well-known. Mm-hmm. So when you make decision in the last day of your life, the most thing you need is a strong desire and dedication and calculation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But when you look at the, not the first day, say the 6 months child,
okay,
they don't know the stairs are dangerous.
Yep.
They are not afraid of anything because they have not been framed by the situation.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That's wildness.
Right, a newborn is not afraid of the tiger, as we say, right?
Yes, uh-huh. yes. We hope that, I hate calculation.
Mm-hmm.
That's why people hate some of the politics.
I see.
Politicians, many politicians uh-huh. Made too much calculation.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And people do not like it. So we don't want to train people, we don't want to educate people to treat every day as the last day, because the last day has so many things predetermined by previous passes.
Mm-hmm.
I want you to imagine that you're in the first day of your life.
Okay.
You don't know much risk.
Yep.
You do some calculation, but mm-hmm. not that delicate calculations.
Mm-hmm. And dare oneself to take all the risks.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Excellent. I think that should be the mantra of the new millennium. All right, so my last question. You've written many books. We just talked about one, but there's many, many more. And of course, you've also been a massive reader. Now, I believe that there's also the key source of many of your innovative ideas came from reading. But in the digital era, in the era of, well, TikTok or other delivery mediums, it seems that short audiovisual productions are more appealing, not just to young people and kids, but for the elderly as well. So how would we communicate the more traditional textual pleasures of a slower reading or writing in the digital age?
There was once I talked to the Minister of Cultural Affairs, Wenhuabu. He described almost the same thing, that videos are more influential. But to my memory, there are several novels, written ones, that are very influential. First is Annie's Diary. That pretty much influenced the establishment of Israel. A second one is Uncle Tom's Cabin. That pretty much influenced the Civil War of the United States and the liberalization of the black people. The third one is many writings by Bjornson. That's a Norway writer who was actually a Swedish citizen when he wrote that. And that pretty much influenced many Swedish people's intention whether to invade Norway when it declared independence. Those are three novels I can think of that pretty much changed the history. That's deep. I try to find three videos that are as deep as those. So I think reading books is different from quick and powerful visual things. They are different. Sometimes we need both to have a solid, comprehensive view to history, to many other things.
Okay, so basically watch video when you want to have fun, but for deep works, read a novel or anything textual. Okay, I'm still trying to think about the video that impacts me the most. Maybe the astronaut walking on the moon. that's something that's pretty deep also.
Because
it showed the possibility.
Okay,
so thank you again, Cyrus, for appearing on Innovative Minds. And so for our viewers, please check more information and videos on TaiwanPlus.com. Also, we have a YouTube channel. So if you like today's episode, be sure to subscribe and share. See you next time. Live long and prosper.
How do I feel this interview? I think Tang Feng is a very good host. And I think the outline of the questions are very well prepared. It's excellent. English interview? I can do... No, I don't have to... I don't need any preparation for English talking. Yeah. So it doesn't matter if it's an English interview or Taiwanese interview. Yes, there was a question about general education. I forgot to ask that. General education is 先学做人, 再学做专业人. For instance, you learn to be an individual first before you become a journalist, a scientist, a physician, or anything like that. Taiwan's education is not good. In one sense, is that the lack of general education, the lack of the good general education. So many people get into a very narrow field too early before they actually have a healthy, general, balanced view of everything. Sometimes I do a comparison. Students in northern Taiwan, it's more open, probably because of Tianlongguo is more internationalized. Students in the southern part are more conservative. Sometimes I tell a joke,
they even dare not laugh out. I think students in the middle part is something in the middle is better. Northern students are too open. Sometimes when I give a speech, the students want to sleep. They sleep like that. They don't have any manner. They are too individualistic.
Okay, very wild.
Very wild. Too wild.
Too wild. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
I'm Cyrus. See you on TaiwanPlus.